worship today. God. He's the God who saves us. He's always with us.
So go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. You guys remember that, right? You remember that song?
It's His amazing grace that we're telling about. Jesus Christ is born.
So go tell it on the mountain.
Praise his name. That gift of Jesus, the baby who was born. I'm celebrating that time right now. And we know that God is always with us.
He is with us today.
Not a king adorned in splendor, robed in glory, but a baby in a manger born to save. Not a warrior who fights his way to power, but a friend who faced the cross to set us free. Sing, you are with us. You are with us. You are with us in every moment. You are with us. You are Jesus. You are Jesus in every moment. You are with us. Wrapped in rags, receive the gift of heaven. Word you bring the dead to life again. You were there from the beginning of creation, with the promise to be with us in the end. You are thank you.
on the mountain, in the valley, in the crowded streets, or the empty desert, in our hope, and in our waiting, we are never alone. God is with us.
Amen. I know you can't see me online right now, but Matt, we'll get that taken care of here pretty quick. Matthew 1:23. Kind of been a theme verse for us as we've been looking at this God with us series. We're going to read it every week, and then we're going to deal with it and talk about God with us always when we gather together on our Christmas Eve service. And we'll do that again then the 26th. Of December. Let's read it together. Are you ready? Then the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means, say it with me out loud, God with us. So we looked last week about how we experience the presence of God in the valley. And if you were with us, we talked a lot about the truth that we often enjoy God on the mountaintop, but we really become to experience God and to know God and his character intimately when we are in the valley. And so today we're going to look at another metaphor from Scripture. It's the wilderness. Now, the wilderness is different than the valley. You see, we pass through the valley, but sometimes in the wilderness, we hang out a little longer. We wander around in the wilderness, and we wonder sometimes if we're ever going to get out of this. It's interesting to me that when you look at wilderness stories in the Bible, that they often follow mountaintop experiences. Maybe you remember that happened to Jesus, and he had a mountaintop moment with God right after he was baptized by John the Baptist in the Jordan River. Literally, the heavens opened up, the Bible says, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove, and the Father said, "This is my beloved Son. I love him. I am well pleased with him." It's a father saying, I'm proud of a son. And that's good to hear. That's a mountaintop moment. And then there's the very next verse. Immediately, the Bible says, immediately, Jesus was driven into the wilderness to be tempted for 40 days. Mountaintop followed by wilderness. Some of you know what that is, right? Some of you understand things were going great, and then you found out that someone wasn't being honest with you, and suddenly you're in a wilderness. You thought your spouse was being faithful, but your spouse wasn't. And now you're in the wilderness. You're in a financial wilderness. You're trying and trying and trying to get out of it this time. And the debt is so real and you feel desperate. Whatever you do doesn't seem to work. And you've tried to tell people how you feel. And they just don't seem to understand. You feel alone and you feel dejected and spiritually dry. You feel desperate in the wilderness. Now, here's the big thought. You need to get this one. Write it down. It's in your listening tonight. God is with us even when we're not where we're supposed to be. I'm with you. Can you hear this? I'm with you, but this is not where I want you. We see that in 1 Kings chapter 19. So turn in or turn on. We're going to look at 1 Kings chapter 19. That's right. If you have a copy of the scripture, then open it up to 1 Kings chapter 19. Let's read together. If you don't, I'll feed you. But let's get used to opening the Word of God. And whether you do that electronically or you know, the old-fashioned way, you know, one of those book kind of things that actually has pages. Some of us maybe still remember what those are. Just turn into 1 Kings chapter 19. And I want to read, because here's where God used Elijah in massive ways. On the mountaintop to the wilderness, and now he's desperate. We find him depressed, and he feels all alone, and he's running for his life. Here's a little context. Elijah had this tremendous victory over the prophets of Baal. You remember the fire that rained down and consumed the altar, and that all of those prophets of Baal were slaughtered. And you remember that he prayed for it to rain. He prayed for it to not rain for 3.5 years. He doesn't stop praying until he sees the clouds begin to gather, and then he runs ahead of Ahab's chariot. Now, let's just start in verse 1. Are you ready? Here's what it says. Now, Ahab told Jezebel everything that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Verse 2, it says, and so Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah to say, may the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them. And now let's do a little more. Ahab, he's the king. He's the king of Israel. He's the most wicked king they've had to date. He marries Jezebel, and she too is wicked, and she worships Baal. She carries it even further, and she sets up all of these temples to the honor and worship of these false gods, and she's killing the prophets of the one and true living God. Kind of looks like Ahab's a little bit of a weak dude when you read about him. Either he didn't have the courage to stand up to Elijah, or he doesn't have the courage to stand up to his wife. It almost looks like Ahab is viewing at least moderately positive as he never grabs Elijah and says, stop it. He doesn't defend the prophets of Baal. He doesn't intercede. In fact, he does everything that Elijah tells him to do. It's really not even hard to imagine that he gets out of his chariot and he sits down at the dinner meal with his wife, Jezebel, and he looks over and says to her, hey, babe, I just think we're going down the wrong road with Elijah. I think we need to rethink this because you wouldn't believe what happened. I wish you could have seen it. I wish you could have been there. He called down fire from heaven and the prophets are dead. Can you imagine Jezebel's fork falling to the floor? What? What did you say? The prophets are dead? Yeah, that's exactly right. Elijah slaughtered them all of them. Jezebel said, I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill him. So she sends a messenger. Just so you know, by this time tomorrow, you're going to be dead. And by the way, coming from Jezebel, this is no idle threat. She had already been killing the prophets of the one true living God. Elijah had no reason to doubt that he would not meet the same fate. Now look at verse 3. In verse 3, Elijah was afraid, and he ran for his life. And when he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there. Now clearly, Elijah didn't see it coming. You didn't see it coming, did you? It kind of came out of the blue. Wow, I didn't know that was going to happen. Man, everything was rocking along just fine, and then all of a sudden, you're in a wilderness. You didn't see it coming. And notice, if he would have saw it coming, he would have ran the other direction, but he didn't. And so he's running for his life in Scripture. He came to Beersheba in Judah, and he left his servant there. He's like the construction guy, you know, he's retiring and he's selling his truck and he tells his helper, man, you've been great, you've been awesome, but I'm getting out of this business, this line of work. I'll give you a reference, but I'm done. So he ran. No bus pass, no Uber, no horsepower. This was foot power. And he runs 100 miles to get away from this crazy, angry woman. He turns into Forrest Gump. Run, Elijah, run. And he runs for 100 miles. Hashtag failure. He failed. Did he? It's a reminder. What it is, it's a reminder that he's just people. He's like us. You see, we know that God is with us, but sometimes we're not where we're supposed to be. So what happens to this spiritual beast? He was just on a mountaintop. Elijah had called down fire from heaven. Imagine that. He believed God. He trusted God. He obeyed God. God told him to confront Ahab, and he did. He went toe-to-toe with the prophets of Baal. He prayed that it would rain, and it did. Bravery, courage, and faith. Elijah, the super saint, running for his life. Notice in verse 4. So he left the servant there, and he went on himself a day's journey into the wilderness, and he came to a broom bush, and he sat down under it, and he prayed that he might die. I've had enough. Underline that. He said, I've had enough. He said, take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors. In the wilderness, he's alone, and he's scared, and he's hurting, and he's desperate. Been there? Maybe it's just weird to me. I don't know. Maybe it's just weird to me. But did you notice in verse 3, he worried about dying, and here in verse 4, he wants to die. I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out. All he had to do is just hang around Jezebel a little longer, and she would have taken care of that for him. But he's out in the wilderness. That's what happens in the wilderness, right? In the wilderness, it's where you're not supposed to be. And it doesn't make sense. You don't make sense. You say weird things when you're in the wilderness. When you get out of the will of God, you say all kinds of strange and unusual things. He said, here, I've had enough. I'm done. I'm at the end of my rope. I'm spent. I can't do this anymore. Have you been there? Have those words ever come out of your mouth? Does any of this sound familiar? If you're raising teenagers, at some point you have said, I've had enough. Somebody say, man. Maybe down at that workplace situation, you know. One day you just say, you know, I just can't take this place anymore. Some of you have said that. Or you're just trying to get your finances in order and you're making progress and then your car breaks down and then your toilet overflows. And like in my home this week, your water heater goes out. Or your two-year-old puts a Tic-Tac up their nose and it's I-ho, I-ho, it's off to the emergency room we go. That's happened, huh? And it might have happened even during Thanksgiving this year. Some of you worked so hard and you made that meal, the greatest meal ever. You made it with love. You ate it. You set it out on the table, and they all came in, and they ate it in 30 seconds, and they left the dishes on the table, and you turned into Jezebel. Somebody's going to pay for this. I've had enough. I can't take it anymore. I'm done. Have you been there? Maybe you're there right now. And you're wondering why things aren't working out. And by the way, this is going to be a revelation to somebody today. Maybe somebody in this room or somebody with us online. Things don't always work out. Good guys don't always win. And the faithful do not always prevail. And in our way of thinking, things don't always work out. And some of you have been told that they do. But get this, it's not true. It took me a while to learn this one. Because I know what Romans 8:28 says. I committed to memory as a young boy. All things work together for the good of them that love God and that are called according to his purpose. And that's the key that we miss. So we say things like it will work out in the end. God is going to bring something good out of this. We all say amen. But what I've learned is that this verse is surrounded by a lot of other verses in Romans chapter 8. There are a lot of other verses. When you read it in the context, what you discover is that Paul is talking about the process of sanctification. That's the process. That's the big theological word for you and I becoming more and more and more like Jesus. That's the purpose. The purpose is not to give you tremendous health your entire life. The purpose is not that you might get a raise down there where you work. All things are going to work together for good them that love God and call according to his purpose. That means that I'm going to get a new truck next week. That means that I'm going to get exactly what Santa Claus is supposed to bring me. That's not what it means. This is not dealing with circumstances. It's dealing with sanctification. And what happened on that moment that you called on the name of the Lord and you invited him into your heart to be your Savior and to be your Lord, here's what happened. You got on a sanctification train, man. You're on the sanctification train, becoming more and more and more like Jesus, which is his purpose in your life. But here's what happens. We're on the train, and I get it. I understand. Sometimes we step back a few cars along the way, right? Is that only me or is that you? I mean, I've been on the train, and then sometimes I've thought, well, you know, maybe I'll just be back here for a little. But here's the point. You never get off the train. You're still on the train. God's purpose is still in place in your life to become more and more what he wants you to be. You don't get off the train. Because here's why. He's going to finish the work that he has begun in you. He is faithful, the Bible says, to complete what he has started in you. You You're going to become more and more and more like Jesus. So this is not a reference in Romans 8:28 to our life circumstances. It's not saying you won't be crushed. Ask everyone who has given their life's blood for the faith. Not for a spiritual perspective. That worked out pretty good for them, right? But from life circumstances, not so much. Some of us operate with kind of a country music theology. We're just all going to meet in the middle beneath that old Georgia pine. I'm going to be faithful to God, and he's going to come in and bless it, and he's going to work it all out. But the Christian life is not a country song. Jesus flat out said, in this world you will have tribulation. I've overcome the world, he said, not you. Elijah didn't see it coming. You didn't either. But he's in the wilderness. He's wilderness bound. And it's more than he can handle. How many of you heard or said, like me, that God will not give you more than you can handle? I've said it, but it's not true. Stop saying it. Because God will absolutely allow situations in your life that you can't handle on your own. Why does it happen? Listen, is to drive us back to him, drive us back to his presence, drive us back to his power, drive us back to his provision. God with us, but sometimes we're not where we're supposed to be. And so we need his presence, and we need his provision, and we need his power. Because guys, listen, the wilderness is real, and it's hard, and it saps the very life out of us. For Elijah, he wanted to die. Then he comes to this sober recognition of himself. The Bible says this, Elijah declares, I'm no better than my fathers. And apparently at some point, Elijah thought that he was better than his fathers. He might have had some good reason. Remember, Elijah was the first guy that God used to raise someone from the dead. He had to think, wow, that's pretty awesome. Fire coming out of heaven and consuming the altar that is completely absorbed in water. Wow. I was here for that. The rain. I'm praying that it'll rain. And look, there's a cloud. Amazing. But it doesn't go the way he thinks. You see, the brutal reality comes to set upon his heart. And it's what James would write of him about hundreds of years later. He would say that Elijah, you're just a guy with a nature like us. All that good stuff that God was working through you was really God working in you. It was never you. And Elijah's depressed and he's under a tree and he's in a desolate wilderness and he's done because adrenaline only lasts so long. Mountaintop's pretty cool, right? They're great. You get a great view on the mountaintop, but we don't live there. We spend most of our time navigating the wilderness, don't we? One of my favorite old preachers, Charles Haddon Spurgeon of the 19th century, known as the Prince of Preachers. Charles Haddon Spurgeon was also known to be a person of great depression. He dealt with great bouts of depression his entire life. And I love this one quote, and I'm going to read it to you, and just check it out. I'm going to go fast. Fits of depression come over the most of us. Usually, cheerful as we may be, we must at intervals be cast down. The strong are not always vigorous, the wise not always ready, the brave not always courageous, and the joyous not always happy. There may be here and there men of iron where wear and tear produce no perceptible detriment. But sure the rust frets even these, and for ordinary men the Lord knows and makes them to know that they are but dust. Elijah, you're but dust. Pastor, you're but dust. You're going to experience the wilderness, everybody in this building this morning. You're not above it. You're going to experience it. It's amazing to me on this train of sanctification that you will be on mountaintops at times, and at other times you'll be wandering around in that wilderness wondering, where are you? How did this happen? Did anybody get the license plate of that truck? How did I end up here? But there's not a person under the sound of my voice this morning that doesn't know what it is to wander in the wilderness. Whatever that means, metaphorically, whatever that means in your life, it's true. And you might find yourself depressed, discouraged, overwhelmed. I can't take it anymore. I can't do this anymore. I'm at the end of my rope. I'm spent. I'm done. Put a fork in me. But look at what Elijah did in verse 5. Get this. Then he lay down under the bush and he fell asleep. Get this morning. Some of you need to hear this. Sometimes the most spiritual thing you can do is to lay down and go to sleep, take a nap. It's true. I've been a little overwhelmed the last few weeks, maybe even much longer than that. And so I gave it a try this week, and on one day I just laid down in my study and I just went to sleep. It was weird. I don't do that. It was strange, but you know what? It was good. Get some rest. Get some rest. Eat the right kind of foods. Do you hear what he's saying? Because some of us are just tired. Ask someone how you're doing, and if they don't say I'm fine, they'll typically say I'm busy. I'm busy, busy, busy. How you doing? I'm busy, I'm busy. How you doing? I'm just tired. I'm tired. I'm so tired. I'm busy. I'm tired. And Amber, you need to write this guy's name down. Dr. Henry Cloud, one of the great Christian psychologists, and I've read him for years, and I would highly encourage you to subscribe to his podcast. Maybe you have read him. Amber, have you read Henry Cloud? Get a hold of everything Henry Cloud has ever written. Read it. Great intellectual psychologist who loves Jesus and preaches Jesus. He said for the most of us, it's not that we're so tired. He said, that's not the problem for the most. He said, you're probably misdiagnosing your challenge. He said, you're not just tired, but you're spiritually depleted. And somebody needs to hear this today. I'm convinced somebody in this building, somebody today needs to know that you're not just tired. You're misdiagnosing your challenge. You're spiritually depleted. And what you need is an encounter with a very real and a very holy presence of God, because God is with you, but you're not where you're supposed to be. God is with you, but you're not where you're supposed to be. This needs to speak to someone, because you're not just tired. Maybe you do need some rest. Sure. Maybe you do need to lay down and get some sleep. But you're also spiritually depleted. And you need the grace and the goodness and the presence of God in your life. By the way, that's what David said in the 23rd Psalm. You know it by heart, right? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He restores my soul. Elijah, look at him. He's physically exhausted. He's spiritually depleted. And I love this part. And God doesn't give him 10 verses to memorize. He doesn't prescribe 2 Philippians 4:13 and call me in the morning. You see that? He doesn't ask, hey, Elijah, partner, man, where's your faith? He doesn't do that. Here's what he did. He told him in verse 5, he said, just get up and eat. Get up and eat. A little side note, this is why when you wake up on Sunday morning and you decide you do not want to go to church, you should go anyway. Because you need to eat. You become spiritually depleted without the word and without the fellowship of believers. You need it. Look at verse 6. He looked around. And there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals in a jar of water. And he ate and he drank. And then he laid down again. Now maybe Elijah is like me. Maybe like you. I don't always get it the first time, right? So notice verse 7. So the angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you. This is what you do when you're trying to wake your kids up. Hey, you know, it's almost time for school, get up. Then you go do something else and you come back. Hey, I told you, get up. The Lord came to him a second time and said, get up. You need to eat. You need some rest. You need to have some sustenance. This journey is too much for you. And this journey is too much for all of us. Notice in verse 8. So he got up and he ate and he drank and he was strengthened by that food. And he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb. Now that's another 200 miles. This is the same mountain that Moses was on for 40 days when it's also called Mount Sinai, when he was receiving those 10 commandments. It's the mountain of God. Man, then notice in verse 9. So there he went into a cave and he spent the night, and the word of the Lord came to him. Underline this. What are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here? What are you doing here? Can you hear God say, I'm with you, but this is not where I want you? Have you ever heard God say that to you? I'm with you, but this is not where I want you. Do you know that experience? Have you been to those places in your life, those seasons, those moments of confusion, those wilderness wanderings where you found yourself in a place where you know God is with you because he's promised he'll never leave you or forsake you, but yet you're not where you're supposed to be because you're running away. You know better than that, but I'm here. He says, I don't leave my people. I don't forsake you. So what are you doing here? Notice in verse 10, I won't throw it on the screen, but Elijah told God, you know, I've been working so hard. You got to get the flavor of verse 10. Are you ready? God, I'm the only one. I've been working so hard. Nobody else is helping me. I mean, all these other prophets, they're getting killed, and I'm going to get killed. I'm doing all of these things for you. Now, maybe it's just me. But have you ever said that? God, I'm doing everything right. I'm doing everything right. It's just not working out. Everyone else has rejected you, but not me, God. I'm the only one left, and they're trying to kill me. He's in a spiritual wilderness. He's hurting. His need is so great that he cannot see beyond his own need. Nobody understands. Nobody's doing it like I'm doing it. I'm all alone. I'm desperate. And what does God do? Notice this. God meets him in his deepest need. God ministers to him in this moment of vulnerability. God brings healing in the middle of hurt. You got to love what verse 11 says. Read this one. The Lord said, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. I don't miss this because Elijah had to be thinking, all right, yeah, right on, Lord. You're going to come and see me. Isn't that the way it is sometimes? It's amazing to me. God is present in this room right now, but so many of us don't even see him, don't even sense him. Come back next week. I'm going to talk about God in the storm. I'm going to talk about those angels that are surrounding you right now, and you don't even see them. I got a couple of them right behind me. Yeah. And they're with me. You do too. But you don't see it. I don't see it. I'm looking in the wrong place. I'm in the wrong place. My mind is in the wrong place. My feet are in the wrong place. You got to know that he's thinking right at this moment, okay, God, I know what it is to walk in your presence. I'm here. God's saying, look, I'm here all the time. I've been with you the whole time. But you're not where you're supposed to be. But in his mind, he's thinking, okay, here it is, finally. God's going to come and visit me. God's going to reveal himself to me. Notice what it says. And it says, then a great, powerful wind. I won't turn you to all those scriptures. I don't know if I've got it. Yeah, I do. Verse 11. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. He's thinking, okay, God's going to be in the wind. God's coming in this rushing and mighty wind. But then the scripture says, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, the Bible says, it was an earthquake. And surely, now he's thinking, okay, God is in the shaking of the ground. I mean, surely he's in this earthquake. But the Bible says, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And then after the earthquake, the Bible says, came a fire. Now, okay, here it is. I mean, I remember Moses in the burning bush thing. It was not consumed. And in the presence of God, my God is coming in the fire. But the Bible says that the Lord was not in the fire. But after the fire came, you remember? Came a gentle whisper, a whisper. The ground shook and God wasn't in the shaking of the ground. The wind raged and God was not in the wind. The fire burned and God was not in the fire. There, here you go. You got earth, wind, and fire. See what God did there? For you guys, you old rockers from the 1970s, See, God was not in this remarkable, I mean, this magnanimous. See, here's our problem. We want to see God in these great magnanimous ways, and if we don't, then we don't see God. I mean, God, you've got to reveal yourself in a remarkable way. And it kind of gets all over my little spiritual hairs start raising up when I hear people say, man, they got this tremendous testimony. Every one of you have a tremendous testimony. Well, yeah, but he did all these drugs and you know, he was a Hell's Angel and he was, you know, he was a Satanist high priest and he comes to know Jesus and he's got all this great story. Listen to me this morning. Everyone who has gone from unforgiveness to forgiveness, who has gone from lostness to foundness, has a tremendous testimony. You once were lost and now you're found. That's right. But we want to see him in the supernatural. Let's get a bus together, you know, because there's some dude coming into town and he's going to be preaching somewhere and we got to go. Or there's some Bible conference of some very famous person who's written 10 books and we got to gather a group together. There's nothing wrong with that. All you ladies who like Jennifer Rothschild, I do too. But it's not about that. It's not about us waiting for some extravagant experience. We've got to go out somewhere to find it. Did you know that Northwest Church is a place where God's Holy Spirit is present today? And if you want to see him today, all you have to do is just listen. You just got to listen. You got to listen because he'll come to you and he will whisper to you. I don't understand it. My God, I'm in a wilderness. Why can't you speak to me in a loud voice, but it's still and it's small and he whispers to me? Do you know what I'm talking about? God was in the whisper. Why is that? God, why are you so quiet? If God wants us to hear him, why does he whisper? He whispers. Listen to this. Listen to this. This is a revelation. He whispers because he's close. He's close. He's with us. He whispers because he's near. It's the devil that shouts his lies, but God whispers his truth. Whispers his truth. You see, God doesn't shout to get your attention. He whispers to draw you close. What does he say to you? I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will never leave you in the wilderness. I'll be with you. This is not where I want you. Follow the still small voice of a powerful God. So I'm sitting in my favorite chair, and I say to Brenda, bring me some Diet Coke. She says, huh? Could you please bring me some Diet Coke? She said, I can't hear you. But then she comes into my presence. She comes next to me. And she hears every word I say. You see how it works, God with us? You see the power in the Emmanuel, the incarnation? You see the miraculous event that this first Christmas was all about? It was about God coming to you and saying, hey, I'm never going to leave you. I'm never going to forsake you. I've been with you every single moment. I love you more than you could ever imagine. And when you hurt, I hurt with you. And when you're in the valley, and when you're in the wilderness, and when you're in the storm, I'm with you. I'm with you. Psalm 34:18 says it like this. The Lord is close. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Can you hear him whisper? Close. And David said it like this. He said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He restores my soul. And even though I walk through the valley, listen, the valley is not my destination. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. Because why? Because he is with me. He's with me. is with me, and because he never leaves me, and because he is always close, his rod and his staff, they comfort me, and he anoints my head with oil, and he sets this table before me in the presence of my enemies. Surely his goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. Why does God whisper to his sheep? Because they're close. And get this, the New Testament says he knows his sheep by name, and his sheep know his soft and gentle voice. David said of God's presence, he said, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up into the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you're there. If I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand guides me and your right hand holds me fast. Your right hand holds me. You're there. He's close. I love that imagery. Listen to this. How close is Jesus? Yeah, he's so close that you can hold his hand. See, did you hear what David's saying? How close is he to you? He's so close that he can hold your hand. Isn't that awesome? That's the presence of God. And what you need to hear is that God loves you and that he's for you, and he's always close. He's always close. He's always close. He wasn't in the booming earthquake. He wasn't in the rushing wind. He wasn't in the raging fire. Where was he? He was in the whisper. He was in the whisper. Matthew 1:23, the virgin will be with child and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Why does our God whisper? He whispers because he's close. He's with us. That's good news. That's good news. That God, in the person of Jesus, his name Emmanuel, God with us, perfect in every way, who became the sacrifice for our forgiveness of sin. Jesus died in our place. He rose from the dead. And anyone who calls on his name will be saved. That's powerful. And that's why Elijah shared this with us. So we would know that God meets us in the wilderness. He didn't leave him there, and he won't leave you there. I'm with you, but this is not where I want you. I want you to know forgiveness. I want you to know peace and joy. That's what he wants. Several years ago, we took the boys to Disney World in Orlando. And we only had one day, so we wanted to do it right. So we were there before the gates actually opened, ready to go. They were a little younger than y'all's kids, and the youngest especially, and he was a little guy. You know, they don't have Mickey's hand, but he couldn't reach a lot of those. Oh, what? Well, sorry, Pod, now you're just not big enough yet. And we had quite the day. And again, we did everything there was to do in that day. We were absolutely just spent. The youngest was so worn out, I'm holding him. And he's so just dead dog tired. We get on the tram and he's asleep in my arms. We get to the car and he's asleep. And we lay him down. He's asleep. We get to the hotel and I pick him up and we carry him. We're on the elevator and he's still asleep. He's out. Lady gets on the elevator with us, and she looks at us, and we look like we've just been dragged through the mud, and we had. And she says, I just love it when they're done for. I said, well, maybe she's speaking in my mind. I'm thinking maybe she's speaking German or some other language. I didn't quite catch that. And I said, I'm sorry, ma'am. I didn't understand. What did you say? They're just so beautiful when they're done for. Done for. I get it. You're right. He's tired. He's exhausted. And you know, when the elevator stopped at her floor, she got off the elevator and she turned around and again with a smile, she said, I just love it when they're done for. I said, yeah. Yes, ma'am. Have a good evening. You know, I've thought about that. And I've asked the question, do you think God thinks we're at our best when we're on the mountaintop? That's rhetorical because I really don't think he does. But don't you think God sees us at our best when we're done for? I mean, when all we can do is climb up into his arms and say, it's too much. It's too much. I need you with me. It's too much. And can you hear him whisper, you're not done for long. Get some rest. Eat something. The wilderness is tough. And it looks like you're done for. It looks like there's no way out. And I want you to know my grace. I want you to know my peace. Because you're not done for ever. With him, we have hope, peace, and joy. And by the way, you don't find that in the absence of trouble. Real hope, joy, and peace is found in the presence of Jesus. I wonder if you can hear him whisper. Wherever you are, whatever you've done, I'm here. Even when you're not where you're supposed to be, I'm here. And I'm here, and he's whispering to you today. Just come.